Today, in part 22 of our series, The Story, we move on to the Gospels to learn about the birth of Christ the King as told in Matthew and Luke. So what about Mary? And what about Joseph? And then the rest of the story. Here's Pastor Seth.
Everybody has seen those Christmas plays where you have the little kids come in with their robes and their ropes and doing the whole manger scene and the angels and the kings and all that stuff. And I'm always intrigued when they do this about who plays the innkeeper. Because there's really no bad guys in the show except for the innkeeper. And I always feel sorry for the innkeeper. You just kind of want to boo and hiss. You know, what kind of person would look at a 9-month pregnant woman and say, no, sorry, we can't accommodate you. Yeah, I've done everything I can. I don't know what else to do. Give us your bed. How about that? Or let us just sleep in the living room. That'll be fine. And there have been some times where when you see this or you think about this, I think, I just wish I could go back in time and just push the pause button. Right at that moment when Joseph is walking up and knocks on the door and the innkeeper opens the door and Joseph asks, do you have a place where we can give birth to our baby? Pause. Wouldn't you like to be able to do that? To go back to that guy and say, before you open your mouth and say something incredibly stupid, you need to know who that baby is. This is no ordinary baby. This is the one that you have read about in the Old Testament scriptures and goes back hundreds of years in covenants and promises. He's going to be the Savior of the world. But if for no other reason you think you can't do that, well, consider the little woman out there who's about to give. She's a teenager. This is her first. Not going to be a happy pregnancy. Or consider the man Joseph. He is in the line of David and the tribe of Judah. That should ring a bell. But if for no other reason, if that still doesn't jar you, if you say to them what you're about to say to them, from now on, the rest of your life and through all eternity, you are going to be, oh, so you're that guy. The innkeeper. If for no other reason, at least to avoid shame, change what you're about to say. Now, then I thought, well, what happened if you could go back and tell the innkeeper that? And he made a different decision. And then I thought about, well, what happened if that whole story happened today and the innkeeper had a completely different view of this? What would the Christmas story look like? I thought, well, Jesus probably would have been born instead of in a little manger or a garage or something. He would have been born at the Radisson Hotel and Casino, just up the road here, in the penthouse. And instead of swaddling clothes and rags, he would have had everything. And when the shepherds come running into the lobby, somebody would on the phone call, we need security in here quick. Get these guys out of here. And somebody from the city would have been calling to say, you're violating city codes and ordinances about these animals. Get them out of here. But it didn't happen that way. I can't think of a more humbling, humiliating way to bring a baby into this earth than the way that happened. I'm not a farm guy, I'm not a ranch guy, but I've been around enough animals to know. And giving birth to a baby like that. It's a long time to wait if you're pregnant. 9 months is a long time. If you know me, I don't like waiting. If we go out to a restaurant, I don't like to wait for more than about 15 minutes. I'd rather just go somewhere else. 15 minutes tops. When I was a kid and Christmas was coming up, Christmas Eve was always for us the longest night of the year. And I remember one year, I was about third grade or fourth grade, and I was so, every year somehow I missed Santa. I don't know how that happened. My dad said he saw Santa up on the roof one time. I went out and I couldn't see him at night. Couldn't see him. And one year, I thought, okay, I went to my little sister and brother, we're going to see Santa. So we stole every mirror in the house that was movable. And from our bedroom, we arranged this series of mirrors. I'm sure my folks never saw this. To where we got a view of the fireplace when Santa would come down and the Christmas tree. So we could not only see him come down, we could also watch him distribute the presents. And we stayed there just glued, watching the mirrors. And the time went by so slowly. And we were getting tired. And we were fighting the sleep monster. And we tried to encourage each other to stay awake. He's going to be coming anytime soon. But finally, the sleep monster won out. We all went to sleep. And the next morning, of course, Santa had showed up. And we had missed him once again. I'm terrible with lines. Don't ever get behind me in the ATM, the drive-thru, if there's somebody in front of me. I don't know how many times this has happened to me. But the woman gets her wad of $20 bills out of the ATM, and then for some reason, this appears to her to be the perfect place to do her makeup. I see her grabbing her purse and pulling it over, pulling stuff out and looking up in the mirror, and I'm about to go on. I'm not in the grocery store that often. Obviously. But don't get behind me in a grocery store line, because inevitably I'm behind the woman who pulls out her purse and then pulls out this wad of coupons. And I've done this enough that for the most part now, I'm just going to go buy a magazine, get some coffee, sit down. We're going to be here a while. It's better than freak. I mean, is that a tool that I can use for this? You know, just go buy a magazine and get some coffee. The last time I went to the Dora Faith Orphanage in Mexico, on the way back, it was about a two-hour wait at the border trying to get through. Three hours, yeah. And I was behind Mike and Laura's car, and we could now see the long line of booths to go through. And by that time, you're thinking, you're almost there. And then a line opened up, you know, one of these one that goes to two, and I'm thinking, jackpot! So I scoot over into that line. It was probably 100 yards between where I was and the border. Mike and Laura got through about 30 minutes before I did. Because apparently in the line I was in, somebody was doing transmission overhaul. It took a while to get there. I could have used some of those tools. Waiting is... again, you know, Mark and Jessica waited 9 months for their baby, like many of you. That's a long time to wait. And so is 400 years, which is where we left off last week at the end of the Old Testament. Isaiah 9 says one of the prophecies about the Messiah. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given. Very interesting wording, which we'll look at in a little bit. The government will be on his shoulders. He will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. That was written about 700 years before the birth of Christ. Now, as we've been going through the story, we have God's upper story that continues on through all of history. And then every week in the Old Testament, we've seen our lower story that we live out. And almost every week, there's some kind of chaos and catastrophe. And it looks like the whole thing, your life is about to cave in, and I never dreamed I would be in this situation I'm in. And somehow God, just all through the course, just somehow is able to move the story forward, both at the upper level and in our lower stories, when it looks like we're just up against chaos and confusion and defeat, and somehow what Bob and Judy mentioned about change. Over time, there's something going on in my life that's making me a different person. That's what we see with Joseph and Mary, both in the larger and story. Imagine you're a teenager and you've met the woman of your dreams. Maybe she's 17 or 18. And you're just giddy with delight and you propose. You're shaking like a leaf and she says, yes! And you're just in euphoria. And then as you're planning the wedding, she comes to you with this news that you never dreamed that the woman of your dreams would tell you, I'm pregnant. Especially when you've been raised in a culture where you're saving sex for marriage. You are building this relationship on two pillars of holiness and honor, as Paul would say. And suddenly, how do you process that? You haven't been with this woman sexually. What conclusions do you draw? I can't imagine Mary having to go and tell Joseph this news. That's the lower story that looked like my life is over. What she thought would be a happy moment turned out to be, on the lower story, a scandal. Now let's look at, on the inside of your handout, let's pick up the story in Luke chapter 1 and move from Mary's lower story to a glimpse of the upper story, as Luke records it. In the sixth month of the year, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David, not just a throwaway line. The virgin's name was Mary. And the angel went to her and said, greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you. Now, I don't know what your response would be if suddenly a large angel was standing next to you. But I would feel like I'm about to be called to the principal's office. And apparently the angel thought she might be thinking the same thing. Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son. And there's the bombshell. And maybe the first sonogram. You are to give him, it's a boy, the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called. And then imagine this. Somebody steeped in Old Testament scripture and the prophecies. He will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. That goes back about 14 generations. He will reign over the house of Jacob. That goes back another slew of generations. Over the house of Jacob forever. I can just imagine each of these bullet points just having one explanation point, two exclamation points, the next one three exclamation points, the next one four exclamation points. His kingdom will never end. How's that for a birth announcement? How will this be, Mary asked the angel, since I am a virgin? The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. In other words, this is not going to be your normal sperm and egg conception. This is going to be in the realm of miracle or creation. Closer to that analogy. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she was said to be barren, is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God. I love how the angel finished that little statement. It's sort of like a, no matter where your mind goes with this, remember this. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May it be to me as you have said. Think about this young woman and what she just said. What a statement. Then the angel left her. Now, that's the upper story. And Mary has a chance to hear the upper story from an angel. But still, I don't know, if it had been me within about 5 minutes, I would have been back in my lower story with a lot of questions. And I would have had some dreams that were shattered. What does a young girl dream about when she's growing up? She dreams about marrying her Prince Charming. She dreams about her wedding. Most young ladies I know can have pictures in their minds of what their wedding is going to be like from the youngest of ages. They dream about being a mom and raising children. They dream about being a part of a community and enjoying life with other moms and raising their kids with other moms and their kids. And this 18-year-old, I suspect, suddenly looked at all this, and her dreams that she had of the kind of marriage she was going to have and the kind of family life she was going to have and living there in Nazareth, all of those dreams, I suspect, were just shattered. Shards of glass and all these dreams in the dirt floor of her home. When I think about this, I think, doesn't this sound like a lot of the stories we've read in the Old Testament? Where other people have had these same kind of just like earth-shattering, my life is over, how in the world can I ever recover from this? And it's at those places that God meets us at our lowest and takes us by the hand and lifts us up and says, I'm going to be with you and I'm going to walk you through this. Just watch. If we'll respond like Mary did, may it be to me as you have said. Now, we come to Joseph. I can't imagine the conversation those two had. If you had saved yourself for marriage with her and you hear this word, the first word that comes to my mind is fury. The next word that comes to my mind is betrayal, rejection, replacement. Except what was a scandal to Joseph was a solution to God, as we've often seen in the case. Well, the angel comes to Joseph and gives him a message while he's sleeping. After he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. Joseph, and then notice what the angel does, just similar to Mary, son of David. Back 14 generations. Again, not a throwaway line. Do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife. Son of David would have ratcheted in his mind messianic prophecies through the line of David as spoken by the prophets. Because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. There's validation that comes with Mary's story here. She will give birth to a son. He also gets to see the sonogram. And you are to give him the name of Jesus. It's a boy. Because he will save his people from their sins. In other words, Joseph, just in case you miss the import of this, this is why he's coming. To save his people and to save you from their sins. Now, one of the questions that always comes up in this story is, what is the virgin birth stuff and this overshadowing and things? Why is that so important? Well, this goes all the way back to Genesis chapter 4. When Adam and Eve sinned, those two were born without a sin nature. And they chose to sin anyway. And when Cain is born, and Abel is born, and Seth is born, not me, and others, all of them have a sin nature. That's Genesis 4. And it's chaos. Genesis 5 goes on. By the time Genesis 6 comes on, the world is a mess. And God says, enough! Noah, build an ark. I am going to start virtually all over again. There'll be 8 of you. But as you all know, that didn't solve the problem about our human nature, the virus of sin that lives in every human being. Those 8 started off and they continued to spread the virus over and over and over again, that separates us from God and creates so much conflict and confusion and just the messes and drama of life. The remedy for sin, as we sang about just a minute ago, nothing can cleanse me or change me but the blood of Christ. Nothing. 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 And that's why the remedy for sin had to be someone without that sin virus inside of him. The virgin birth. It was important. Isaiah 7:14, another one of our messianic prophecies, 700 years before this dream. The Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child. Imagine if you heard that 700 years before. What is he talking about? The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son. You will call him Emmanuel. The angel repeats this promise to Joseph. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will be with child, give birth to a son. They will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Joseph awakes from his dream. He gets it. He understands. He sees the upper story. And because he's a stand-up guy, he goes to Mary. He recommits himself. I get it now. I'm not going anywhere. You are not going to be a single, teenage, unwed mother somewhere up in Galilee away from your home. We are going to walk through this together here in Nazareth. Now we come to the Christmas story, Luke chapter 2. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. Now, there's this little hamlet way down in Nazareth where Joseph and Mary live. 1,400 miles away, the emperor calls for a census. He has no idea how important that was. This was the first sentence took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his town to register. And so these two, she's 9 months pregnant by this time, have to travel about 98 miles, from one of my researchers tells me, 98 miles to get to Bethlehem, about a five-day trip by hoof. As Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. None of these are throwaway lines. They are confirming lines. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths, means rags, placed him in a manger. We're not sure if it was a little shack or a little cave. Stinky nonetheless, because, and here we are again, there's no room in the inn. Now, we always get, I always think about the innkeeper and just like, wow, you know, what a moron, what an idiot. How would you say that? But you think about this. Bethlehem's a small town. It appears that they had been there a while. And it's hard to miss a woman walking around when she's 9 months pregnant. I mean, we had lunch yesterday with a woman who was, what, 8 months pregnant? 7 months pregnant? Something like that. It's hard to miss that. Nobody. No one. Not a soul. Not another young mother said, what are you going to do? Where are you going to give birth? Nobody. No mother or no lady that would have been her mother's age came and said, where's your mother? Do you have a place to? Nobody. Nobody my age. No grandmotherly or grandfatherly types came and said, you guys need to stay with us. Not a soul. And when the innkeeper was pressed on this, he said, hey, don't look at me. My hands are tied. All our rooms are filled up. So what they ended up doing was giving birth at the barnyard suite at the manger motel.
I'm waiting to use that one.
Yeah. All week. Think about this scene. You have it in your mind? Can you think of any more humble way that the Savior of the world could be born than this? I can't. And at the same time, can you think of any more fitting picture of how human nature received its Savior than this? What a picture. What a picture of one who would come, and what a picture of our need. This one who's humble knows your heartache. and your heartbreak. And he knows what kept you up last night thinking in the dark. And he knows what got you out of bed early this morning than your alarm clock. He knows the things that came to your mind when Bob and Judy were talking about your life. He came to you, and he is for you. But the question is, will you be like the innkeeper or like the rest of the people in Nazareth who saw him and said, no thanks, I'm good. Good. And in our day, I'm just too busy for that Jesus stuff. I've got my deadlines, my phone lines, my lifelines. I don't have time for all that stuff. Are we any different than the innkeeper? Well, I do like the story of, and we'll finish with this, of the Christian school that had their play. They wanted to do the manger scene and all that stuff, and they practiced, and they gave all the best parts, of course, to the best kids and the smartest kids. So Mary and Joseph were cast early, the angels, the kings cast early. They got everybody cast except for the last person, the innkeeper. And nobody in second or third grade wanted to be the innkeeper. Pretty sharp group. They finally convinced one little boy to say yes. And he said, okay, I'll be the innkeeper. He did okay through all the rehearsals. Although he kept thinking, golly, every time I'm the bad guy here. But he thought he could make it. And then they finally got to the night of the production. And he's backstage, and he's looking out from behind the curtain, and he sees the bright stage lights that seem to be blinding to him. And he looks out at the audience, and he can barely see. But he can tell that it's packed with people, full of adults. And now he's thinking, oh my gosh, I'm going to look like the biggest, worst guy in the whole world. And this guy's anxiety and worry just started to skyrocket. He wondered if he even should go out on the stage. But the play kept going, it was getting closer to him. And he just felt this compulsion that he was sort of pulled into it, and he had agreed to this, and somehow he just needed to do it. And when it came time for the innkeeper scene, there was a change of scenery, and some of the kids rolled out the inn. And as they rolled out the inn, he was walking in there behind, like, oh, what am I doing? Almost like the march of death. And he gets there, and he can look through the cracks, and he can see the bright lights are blinding, and the barely can make out the people, and he sees Mary and Joseph making their way, and it's almost like, oh. And then just before Joseph knocks on the door, it's like the little kid sees the upper story. There's a knock on the door. And Joseph flings open the door and says, welcome! I've been expecting you! And everybody there did just what you did. They just came unglued. And at this little Christian school, all parents are standing up and applauding. And yeah, and cheering. Everybody's giving high fives. And suddenly the kid's like, wow. The director of the show admitted later that she thought about just sending all the rest of the cast out and having baby Jesus right there in the street scene of the thing. That kid saw the upper story. Welcome. We've been expecting you. Let's pray together. Father, our human nature puts up such a stubborn, stupid fight. And our pride is so strong. We just so much want to say, I'm good. Jesus thinks good. It's good for you. Fine. I believe. Yeah, that's good. I really don't need anything more than that. If we hadn't needed you, you would never have sent your son to go through all the CRAP he went through. Maybe in your heart today, it's time for you to say to Jesus Christ, welcome to your rightful place in my heart. The first chair, the most important chair, the pilot's chair, a chair where the Lord and the King should live inside of me. Nowhere else inside of your heart will do. It will make no sense to you unless he's sitting there.
We at Pacific Church of Irvine invite you to join us every Sunday at 9:30. You can also visit our website at pacificchurch.com.